Good morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice, give thanks, and be glad in it. Let us be glad for this day of life, for breath, for our salvation in Jesus Christ. Let us come to offer our gifts of praise and to show our gratitude to God, our Creator, our Redeemer, our Sustainer. Welcome to this time of worship on the Lord's Day. It is always good to gather with you as God's people to worship God in this place. Please sign the friendship pad, share it with one another, and greet each other in the name of Jesus Christ. There are a lot of announcements in the bulletin today about different things happening, not just in this church, but in the life of the community. And I call your attention to those announcements today. We have a minute for mission today. Harriet Ferrier about Celebrate Recovery.
Good morning. The outreach ministry team is in need of help in a couple of areas, so please listen to these opportunities and let me know if you can join us to make these ministries even better. Celebrate Recovery is a program for those recovering from an addiction. It meets every Thursday night at Rose Hill United Methodist Church. Our church prepares a meal and goes to the Rose Hill Church to serve the meal about once a quarter. We need two or three more volunteers to join us and would really appreciate a little more help. Helping Hands Food Pantry is a ministry that provides food for the hungry. The pantry is located in the administrative wing of our church. The ministry is seeking one or several who would be available on Wednesday mornings from 10 till 12 to assist our church secretary in receiving and putting away food that is delivered by Foodline. Please let me know if you're interested in discipling for Christ through Celebrate Recovery or Helping Hands Food Pantry. You would certainly be welcomed. Thank you.
The call to worship is on 647 in your hymn book if you would like to join us. Please join me in the opening sentences as printed in your bulletin. The invitation is given to every person by Jesus Christ. Come to me, follow me, be my disciple.
We come to this place, which is a sign at the invitation of Jesus Christ.
In the name of Christ, we accept the invitation to discipleship.
In the name of Christ, as his disciples, we worship.
In the midst of a world where cruelty abounds, we proclaim the God of compassion.
In the midst of despair, that threatens to swallow up whole lives, we proclaim the God of hope.
In the midst of indifferences and apathy, we proclaim the God of love. Our first hymn is number 22, God of the Sparrow.
God, our Creator and Redeemer, has given us so much, including our forgiveness of sins and salvation in Jesus Christ. Too often we take those gifts for granted, or even as something to which we are entitled. Let us go to God in our prayers of confession, acknowledging our sinfulness and our need for God's mercy and grace in Jesus Christ. Our prayer of confession is responsive, followed by a time of silent prayer, and then a responsive assurance of pardon. Let us pray. Lord, in these moments when our minds wander, God, redirect our thoughts to you. In this week, as we walk your path and sometimes stumble, God, make your way clear. In our communities where we have sometimes remained silent, God, open our lips to speak for justice. In this world where there is much hurt that we sometimes cause, God, make us agents of healing. In this time when there is much sorrow and grief, God, send us out to be ambassadors of hope and joy. In these moments of silence, God, hear our prayers. Sisters and brothers, let us proclaim the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Let us go out into the world as people made new by God. Hallelujah. Amen. Let us sing God's praises for his mercy in our lives. Please be seated. This morning we take up our quarterly path offering, Presbyterian Answer to Hunger. There's information in the bulletin. And just a reminder, it comes back to us in many ways through our Helping Hands food pantry to help people in our community. Thank you for your contributions. Children to join me on the steps for the children's sermon. Oh, Hayes. Hey, Robert. Hey, Windsor. Oh, Burroughs and Wallace. Come on up. I'm glad y'all are here. Okay, that's good. Had to tell Grandma, huh? That's good. Good morning. I'm glad y'all are here. When I was growing up, when I was your age and younger, my mama and daddy taught me two very important words. Can you guess what they were? Has anybody ever taught you the magic words? Well, they taught me that, but that wasn't one of them. He said love. That's a good word. Please. You know what the other one is? It's actually two words, thank you. Yeah, please and thank you, the magic words. But my mom and daddy taught me to say thank you to people for what they did for me. And whenever I got presents, I had to write thank you notes. And when it was Christmas time, and I wanted to play with my toys, I had to sit down and write thank you notes. But you know, I'm glad I did it, because the people that gave me presents, like my grandmas and other people, they took time to do something nice for me, and they always thought about what I might want, and they always gave me things I really liked. And so I'm glad I took time to write a thank you note and say thank you. And I brought a little note here today, a little thank you note, a little card that I thought was pretty. It's got a picture of a little church on it. And it says, a little thoughtfulness can be the greatest blessing of all. And inside it says what? Hayes, can you read that? You know what that says, Robert?
Thank you.
Thank you. I thought we could write God a thank you note. I don't know how I'm going to mail it to him. I do know how we can mail it to him. I'll tell you that in a minute. So what do you want to thank God for? What can we thank God for?
Food.
Hmm?
Food.
All right. What else?
Water.
That's a good thing. What else? Oh, it got to be more than food and water. You know what I thank God for? My family. People that love me. What else?
Steak.
Steak? I'm going to come eat at your house. All right. Yeah, I don't give thanks to God for that very much at my house. All right. Steak. Yeah. Well done or rare? What else can we thank God for? Oh, come on. Let's think real hard. Church? Is that what you said? Okay. Is that what you said? Did you say church?
I said love.
Love. Yeah, that's a good one. Anything else?
Friends.
Friends, yes. That's a real good one. I know what we can thank God for.
What?
Oh, why haven't we said this one yet? Thank him for Jesus. What do you think about that? For sending Jesus to be our Savior. Yeah. I'm going to put down my dogs. Well, I'll put pets, because some people have, they don't have dogs, but I do. Can you think of anything else?
Kittens.
Hmm?
My kittens.
Your kittens? Okay.
Clothes.
That's a good thing to have. Yep. Okay. How about the houses we live in?
Yeah.
Yeah. Ooh, look. Look how long that list
flowers.
Is getting. Hmm? Flowers? Yeah.
School?
We said school. Very good, Wallace. Very good. Your mama's very happy. What a great list. Now, you know, I said I didn't know how I was going to send this to God, but I know how we can send it to God.
Throw it up in the air.
Well, yeah, I could throw it up and see if he catches it. But put a stamp on it, might not get there. But we could pray it and send it to God through a prayer, and he'll hear it. So why don't we pray and thank God, and I'll thank him for all these things that you've listed. You ready? Let's have prayer together. Dear God, thank you for food, for family, for church, for friends, for pets, for water, for steak, for love, for Jesus, for kittens, for flowers, for school, for clothes, for houses, for everything. Amen. Thank y'all very much for coming up. Please join me in our prayer for illumination that's printed in the bulletin. Let us use this as a way to open our hearts to hear God's word. Let us pray today. Lord, open our hearts this morning to hear your words of compassion. Lord, help us truly to listen to you. Lord, open our spirits this morning to strengthen our faith. Help us, O Lord, to learn your lessons of compassion. Lord, keep our minds and spirits open to your life-changing words. Amen.
The Old Testament lesson is taken from 2 Kings chapter 5, verses 1 through 19. I'll read from the New International Version. This is the story of the army commander Naaman being healed of leprosy. Now Naaman was commander of the army of the king of Aram. He was a great man in the sight of his master and highly regarded, because through him the Lord had given victory to Aram. He was a valiant soldier, but he had leprosy. Now bands of raiders from Aram had gone out and had taken captive a young girl from Israel, and she served Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, "If only my master would see the prophet who is in Samaria, he would cure him of his leprosy." Naaman went to his master and told him what the girl from Israel had said. "By all means, go," the king of Aram replied. "I will send a letter to the king of Israel." So Naaman left, taking with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 sets of clothing. The letter that he took to the king of Israel read, "With this letter, I am sending my servant Naaman to you so that you may cure him of his leprosy." As soon as the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his robes and said, "Am I God? Can I kill and bring back to life? Why does this fellow send someone to me to be cured of his leprosy? See how he is trying to pick a quarrel with me?" When Elijah, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his robes, he sent him this message. "Why have you torn your robes? Have the man come to me, and he will know that there is a prophet in Israel." So Naaman went with his horses and chariots and stopped at the door of Elijah's house. Elijah sent a messenger to say to him, "Go wash yourselves 7 times in the Jordan, and your flesh will be restored, and you will be cleansed." But Naaman went away angry and said, "I thought that he would surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, wave his hand over the spot, and cure me of my leprosy. Are not Abuna and Pharpha, the rivers of Damascus, better than all of the waters of Israel? Couldn't I wash in them and be cleansed?" So he turned and went off in a rage. Naaman's servants went to him and said, "My father, if the prophet had told you to do some great thing, would you not have done it? How much more then when he tells you, 'Wash and be cleansed'?" So he went down and dipped himself in the Jordan 7 times, as the man of God had told him, and his flesh was restored and became clean like that of a young boy. Then Naaman and all his attendants went back to the man of God. He stood before him and said, "Now I know that there is no God in all the world except in Israel, so please accept a gift from your servant." The prophet answered, "As surely as the Lord lives whom I serve, I will not accept a thing." And even though Naaman urged him, he refused. "If you will not," said Naaman, "please let me, your servant, be given as much earth as a pair of mules can carry, for your servant will never again make burnt offerings and sacrifices to any other god but the Lord. But may the Lord forgive your servant for this one thing. When my master enters the temple of Rimmon to bow down, and he is leaning on my arm, and I have to bow there also, when I bow down in the temple of Rimmon, may the Lord forgive your servant for this. Go in peace, Elijah said. Our next hymn is number 753, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace.
Please be seated. Our gospel lesson comes from the 17th chapter of Luke, verses 11 to 19. And as I read this story, you might note the similarities between it and the story that Harriet read about Naaman. Listen for the word of God. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him. Keeping their distance, they called out, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. He prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus asked, "Were not 10 made clean, but the other 9, where are they? Was none of them found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Get up and go on your way. Your faith has made you well." May God bless the reading and the hearing of his word. Let us pray. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The Great American Road Trip is back. That's how an article from AAA dated May 19th begins, with predictions of record-setting travel numbers for last weekend's Memorial Day holiday. According to the AAA predictions, more than 38 million Americans would travel on Memorial Day weekend, the second highest Memorial Day travel volume on record and the most since 2005. The president and CEO of AAA, Marshall Doney, said, "Americans are eagerly awaiting the start of summer and are ready to travel in numbers not seen in more than a decade. The Great American Road Trip is officially back thanks to low gas prices and millions of people from coast to coast are ready to kick off summer with a Memorial Day getaway. I'd like to invite you to take a different kind of road trip this summer. Let's call it the Great Gospel Road Trip. In the Gospel of Luke, Jesus is always on the move around Galilee and beyond in the regions up north. In fact, geography and travel help to determine the outline of Luke's gospel, especially in the middle of the gospel. At the end of chapter 9, we read, "When the days drew near for him to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem." With this sentence, Luke sets a geographical framework for the rest of his gospel. Jesus is up north in Galilee, and he is headed south to Jerusalem. But Luke also sets a theological framework within that geography. He writes, "When the days drew near for him to be taken up," that means when Jesus finally reaches Jerusalem, he will die. And 10 chapters later, in the middle of chapter 19, we read, "After he said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem, and then he enters Jerusalem on a donkey for his final week." In the meantime, it takes Jesus quite a while to get from Galilee to Jerusalem. Now, as the crow flies, it's about 80 miles from Capernaum up in Galilee, which was Jesus' headquarters on the shore of the Sea of Galilee, down to Jerusalem in Judea, which was the religious center of Jewish life. Now, even if you walked 3 miles an hour for 8 hours a day, it would only take a little more than 3 days to get from Galilee to Jerusalem. But Jesus meanders all over the place as he makes his way north to south on this road trip. And along the way, he meets all sorts of people. He teaches, he preaches, he heals, he is accepted, he is rejected, and still he makes his way on the road to Jerusalem. In today's bulletin, there is a preaching schedule for the next 2 months. Our road trip with Jesus is going to take us beyond the bounds of chapters 9 through 19. Over the next few weeks, we will encounter a lot of different people in lots of different places. Jesus is going to take us to some surprising places, maybe even to some places we'd rather not go. But as always, we hear Jesus call to us, "Follow me." As I planned my preaching for June and July, I also looked up many hymns to use with the different scripture texts. I gave Carla and Vera a copy of the preaching schedule so they would know what was coming. Now, I haven't talked with Carla yet about upcoming music, so I don't know if the choir will sing Willie Nelson's "On the Road Again" for an anthem. But some of Willie's lyrics are actually pretty helpful as we set out on this road trip to Jesus. "On the road again, I just can't wait to get on the road again, going places that I've never been, seeing things that I may never see again." Today we jump right into the middle of the road trip in Luke 17. As Luke tells us, on the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. Now you remember, I said that it was about 80 miles as the crow flies from Capernaum up in the north to Jerusalem in the south. Well, that's assuming you could walk a straight path from one place to the other. But in reality, the geography won't let you do that, so you do have to meander a bit. And yet in Jesus' day, there were even greater obstacles than geography that got in the way of taking a direct route from Galilee to Judea. Faithful, observant Jews traveling south from Galilee would have detoured to the east and traveled along the east bank of the Jordan River until they could safely cross the river in the southern region of Judea and begin their climb up to Jerusalem. The route that they took was determined far more by racial and religious prejudices and animosity than by any geography. In fact, the Jews and Samaritans didn't associate with one another. They avoided one another, if at all possible. They shared a common heritage in their ancestor Jacob, but the Jews regarded the Samaritans as foreigners. Their differences had to do with rite worship and ritual purity and religious practices, despite what they had in common. So it's somewhat surprising to find Jesus here at the border between Samaria and Galilee, or as Luke puts it, in the region between Samaria and Galilee. Luke is known for his being particular in how he tells this story, so maybe he's just giving us one more geographical marker along the way. But considering what happens in this story, Luke may have a greater theological purpose in mind when he locates Jesus there at the border. He is neither in Galilee nor in Samaria. Or we might say he's in both places at once. The geography is a little bit ambiguous, and maybe that's the way it should be. What is Jesus going to do here in that region between Galilee and Samaria? Will he detour to the east and avoid the dreaded Samaritans? Or will he stay on the road and go wherever it takes him and takes us? This in-between place, this no man's land, this Palestinian DMZ reminded me of what some people call liminal spaces or thresholds. The ancient Celts call them thin places. And the poem in the margin next to this morning's opening sentences describes well these thin places. Thin places, the Celts call this space, both seen and unseen, where the door between the world and the next is cracked open for a moment, and the light is not all on the other side. God-shaped space, holy. Thin places are those rare locales where the distance between heaven and earth collapses. They're in-between spaces where you find that you encounter God up close and personal. For some people, Montreat is a thin space. For others, it's watching a gorgeous sunrise or sunset at the beach. Maybe it's looking into the eyes of your newborn child. Or it could be holding a lighted candle in this sanctuary at the Christmas Eve communion service. It could be at the bedside of a dying loved one. Many times you'll find yourself in these thin places when you didn't even mean to go there. You weren't expecting it. In this story about Jesus and the 10 lepers in that region between Samaria and Galilee strikes me as a story about being in a thin place. The lepers were already living in an in-between place because of their skin malady. They were outcasts socially, religiously, physically. They literally did not belong anywhere anymore, except with each other there in the borderlands. And here on the road at the border, Jesus is about to cross another boundary, a social boundary, written in stone, as he actually takes time to interact with these 10 lepers. By law, by tradition, by personal comfort level, Jesus should have avoided the lepers at all costs, but he didn't. He did not take another road to avoid them. And when he crossed the boundary there at the border, the lives of 10 men were changed. Jesus saw them and he said to them, "Go show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were made clean. And then the story's focus zooms in on one of the men. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back praising God with a loud voice. What a touching story. What a wonderful picture. And before we criticize the other 9 too harshly, let it be said that they were doing exactly what Jesus told them to do. They went to show themselves to the priests. But this one man out of 10 found something even more than physical cleansing that day. He prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And then Luke drives home the surprising point and says he was a Samaritan. The guy had 2 strikes against him. He was a leper and he was a Samaritan. But that didn't matter to Jesus. He didn't add to the man's isolation by saying something like, well, I'll heal you nine Jews, but I can't associate with you Samaritan. And there has to be, I think there has to be some theological significance to the fact that Luke doesn't reveal the man's Samaritan heritage until after he has been cleansed and praised God and laid himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And when the Samaritan leper bowed down at Jesus' feet and praised God and thanked Jesus for cleansing him, the distance between heaven and earth collapsed. We live in a time and in a country where borders are much on our minds, much in the news, much in the politics of the day, where the other, the foreigner, is automatically seen as a threat. Imagine how the Jews of Luke's day heard the story about the Samaritan leper being the only one who returned to glorify, praise, and thank God. The Jews of Jesus' day weren't too happy when they heard about God's mercy and grace and healing powers being given to the Gentiles. Harriet read an interesting story from the Old Testament about an army commander named Naaman. He's not a Jew. He's a Gentile, a good, mighty man who had leprosy. And he is healed of his leprosy by bathing in the Jordan River at the command of Elisha, the prophet of God. When Jesus went home to his synagogue in Nazareth and preached to his hometown folks and the people that knew him from his growing up days, at first they were very pleased with the sermon he was preaching. And then he started stepping on their toes, I think. He told a couple of stories from their scripture, stories that they already knew. And one of the stories was about a Gentile army commander named Naaman receiving God's blessing and healing. And yet, as the Old Testament story tells us, Naaman was so thankful to God that he took some dirt home with him. And I think it was so he could build himself a little shrine and offer his sacrifices on that dirt to the only God there was, in his own words, and to thank God who was graceful to him. On this first leg of the journey on the road with Jesus, Jesus takes us into territory we just as well would avoid traveling through. We're not faithful Jews trying to avoid the Samaritans, but we're all too familiar with the question of the other, the foreigner, those people. And this story has two surprising twists. First, the man who turned back had not one, as I said, but two strikes against him that should have counted him out of God's grace and contact with Jesus, according to the law, according to tradition, according to the way things had always been. Second, the man who turned back and thanked Jesus found Jesus that day. And as one person put it, in leper colonies, the common problem of leprosy made the Jewish-Samaritan distinction unimportant. And being in the presence of Jesus made those distinctions and any others just as unimportant. We may not be Jews or Samaritans. We may not be physically clean and leprous, but we still isolate the other. When in fact, in Jesus' presence, we are all the same. We are all sinners in need of God's grace and salvation. Now remember, all 10 of the lepers were made clean. All 10 of the lepers were healed. It's not as if when that one guy turned back, the other 9 got their leprosy back. But only one turned back and said, thank you, and was called saved. Don't you love Anne Lamott's prayer that's there by the prayer of confession? She says her two favorite prayers are in the morning, help me, help me, help me, and at bedtime, thank you, thank you, thank you. As we go along on the road with Jesus, we may wish sometimes that our spiritual GPS would recalculate when we see where Jesus is calling us to follow him. But if we follow him on the road, we very well will find ourselves in those thin places where the distance between heaven and earth collapses. And we will find ourselves going places that we've never been, seeing things that we may never see again. Let us pray. We thank you, O God, for your love for us, love that reaches out to accept us wherever we are, whoever we are, love that reassures, prompts, challenges, and overwhelms us. Help us who are held within the security of your love to risk showing that same love to others. May our love, grounded in your love in Jesus Christ, be known for its abundance and its healing. Amen. In our prayers today, let us remember the family of Avalee Bowman. Avalee died Friday a week ago, and her memorial service is here today at 2 p.m. Some of you don't know Avalee. She moved up to Raleigh a few years ago to be in an assisted living facility. She and her husband Don owned a Wells Stockyard out there on Highway 117 for years and years and years. Don sang in our choir for years and years. He died back in 2010, and they have a lot of family, and they'll all be here today. So let's pray for all of Avalee's family. Also, let's pray for Jerry Kinlaw. Jerry Kinlaw is Tracy Carr's father. He had a stroke last Saturday. He is at home in Goldsboro. I got an email from Tracy this morning. No paralysis, no speech impairment, no vision problems, but it's having issues with his equilibrium, and they're going to be running some further tests. And a joy, we congratulate Blake and Liza Saunders on the birth of their daughter, Juniper Blake Saunders, on May 31st. Grandparents Emily Saunders, Leon and Jewel Wells, and great-grandma Shirley Carlton. So let's pray together. Lord, we give you thanks for your salvation in Jesus Christ, for your grace, mercy, and love in sending him to be like us and to die for our sins. Lord, we thank you for your healing mercies in our lives. We thank you for all the things that the children listed in their thank you note to you today. Lord, forgive us when we take them for granted. Forgive us even more when we think they are ours by right. Help us to have thankful hearts and in turn to share your love and the good news of salvation with others. Lord, we lift up Avalee's family to you today. We give you thanks for her faithful life and her service to you and to this church and our community. We pray for her family as they gather in this place to worship, and all of the friends as we come together today. Help us to hear the promise of resurrection to eternal life as we celebrate Avalee's life. Lord, we are thankful that Mr. Kinlaw is doing well after his stroke. We pray for these tests that they'll be running. Help them find out how to help him. We pray for Tracy and Watts, for all of their family. Lord, be with them, give them strength. Help Mr. Kinlaw's body heal. And Lord, we rejoice with Blake and Liza as they welcome this little girl, Juniper Blake, and with all of her family. Lord, bless that little girl and her parents. Help her to grow. Lord, help her to know you and to know your love for her. Lord, we thank you for calling us to follow you. Many times we want to go another way, and still you call us, follow me. You tell us that your grace is sufficient for us, and we pray that you will help us trust in that as a church, that we will do what you call us to do in Wallace and in other places. Lord, I pray for people who have heavy hearts today for whatever reason, people who are going through hard times, people who wonder about your love and grace, people who are searching for you. Lord, be with them and help us to know how and when to reach out in your love. And Lord, we pray for the churches of the East community of our presbytery that come together on Saturday in Wilmington. Thank you for calling us into a community where we can celebrate, rejoice, worship, and do ministry together. I pray for all the elders and ministers who will gather next Saturday. Help us to be a faithful church. We give you thanks, O Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's continue our worship as we present our tithes and our offerings. Let us pray. Gracious God, thank you for the wonderful things you have made. Thank you for the universe full of stars and planets. Thank you for our world full of life. Thank you for making each one of us. Thank you for loving each one of us. Thank you for saving us through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Lord, take these gifts we now offer to you. May they be used to the glory of your name. We offer you ourselves and all the gifts you have blessed us with. Take us and use us to share your love with the world in Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us affirm our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 643. Now thank we all our God. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in the one body, and be thankful. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through him. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Amen.